Hello, good afternoon. My name is Gosha, also known as Don't Bother to Read This Long Last Name. And today I would like to present you our work which we did at Mirantis over the last 2 years when we were trying to push the limits of OpenStack scale to some specific number. So initially it was like 400, then like 1,000 nodes, 500 nodes now. So, and at the beginning, it was at the time when we had OpenStack Killer release. We thought it would be relatively easy to do. Just like take whatever we have in OpenStack, allocate like proper hardware resources, and it should just work. But actually, it looked easy, but it was very hard to do. And when we started to do this, we started to see a lot of issues which we never actually thought about and never heard about. So we created Scale App with 300 nodes, and we were trying to like install OpenStack according to our like Mirantis OpenStack reference architecture, and it didn't work. It didn't work due to like various problems, various reasons most of you probably already familiar with. And the one of the biggest problem and one of the biggest challenge which we had is the fact that there were rumors or stories or fairy tales that somebody somewhere did this. So it should work. But unfortunately, there were no documents or like documented solutions. So how it was done, when it was, and when it happened. So we decided to create a team who will focus on pushing those scalability limits for our OpenStack. So at the beginning, it was just Mirantis Lab with 300 physical nodes and 5 engineers. Then actually Intel came in and proposed a hardware lab, actually 2 labs, which we can use to run our scale tests and do our work there. So thank you, Intel. And we decided to fix the initial problem which we had. So we decided to document everything what we are doing and what we did before. And at the bottom, there is a link to the official OpenStack documentation site. So you can find a lot of different information about scale, performance, and reliability. So all the work which we did is available for everybody. So let's quickly talk about our lab. So what do we have and how it works? It's slightly moving, but so we have 2 different kind of servers. So it's all Intel-based hardware. So you can read the specs, probably not for Lenovo. Sorry for that. So it's just like standard commodity servers which you can buy on the market. Nothing special about them except some specific hardware parameters which we were able to secure here. So at the lab, we use standard like spine leaf networking topology. So we use Arista switches at the lab. So their part numbers are here. It's not actually part numbers, but model. So you can find them on the internet and find the information about that. So it's pretty good and reliable network which we have, which with pretty significant like bandwidth and throughput available, which we can use, so that we can run not only scale testing, but we also were able to run data plane testing and find the like performance characteristics of data plane side of OpenStack. So what will happen if you use Neutron with OVS? What will happen when you use Neutron with OVS with DPDK? Or how scalable is DVR and how well it works when you start actually sending traffic from the nodes. So as I mentioned, we had so-called Mirantis OpenStack reference architecture, which was pretty standard topology which we used for our deployments. And it resembles actually three physical nodes which we use to host all OpenStack services and their like control plane parts. And we use additional components like pacemaker and coresync to make sure that it works in HA fashion, so on and so forth. But for bigger scale, when we need thousands of nodes, we don't have hardware for that. So as you saw, our like maximum size of hardware lab was 500 physical nodes. So we decided to actually virtualize this lab. And for that, we use containers, which actually run hypervisor inside. And inside this VM, we run actually Nova Compute, like full-blown standard configuration of Nova Compute with Neutron OVS agents. So it's fully working OpenStack cloud, except the fact that compute nodes are actually virtual machines with nested virtualization. And all services, all OpenStack services, we put into containers so that we can individually actually change number of services which we run to accommodate the specific load on our cluster. So I will go into details later, but that's just a high level overview of what we have in our lab and how it works. So let me step back and go to the history. So this was our first attempt. Actually, this was the second one, but it was first one successful to run OpenStack at scale. So initially it was relatively small scale, like 400 nodes, which you still can find in like some specific companies who host big private clouds. So what we did, we just used our MOS reference architecture, and we're trying to run some specific rally tests, which are again available in the upstream community, to simulate actually OpenStack user activities on this cloud. And again, we faced some specific problems. It was time of the killer release. So Neutron, our like first problem, and RabbitMQ, usual suspect in all like bottlenecks problem. And fortunately for us, we had several community leaders who were working at Mirantis. So Davanom Dims, you probably know him very well, Jay Pipes and Kevin Benton. They actually took those results from our lab and started to figure out what was the problem, so where is the bottleneck, and started to push those activities in the upstream community and trying to find the solution and trying to fix them. So actually, most of those issues were fixed, so that is why I just like doing this like shout out. So once those problems were fixed, it was at the time of Mitaka OpenStack. We were able to run successfully OpenStack Cloud at 400 nodes, and we started actually collecting first numerical values, which we can later compare between like different runs. And we actually started to create a like portfolio of those like performance scale and reliability metrics for each OpenStack service. And you can actually rerun those tests because they were done in form of rally scenarios, and you can go to this like performance document page and find all the links where to find them, and you can actually reproduce those tests and probably compare like your numbers with our numbers to figure out if there are like difference and where might be the problem if you have it. So Neutron, even at Mitaka timeframe, Neutron was the biggest problem to run OpenStack at scale. So that was one of the reason why a lot of hardware vendors or SDN vendors were very successful on customer sites to push their product instead of using standard Neutron OVS with TBR. So there are like specific problems which we had inside Neutron architecture, which had to be fixed and changed. And those fixes were done in the upstream, and right now they do not exist. And you can find the history of what was the problem and how it was fixed in the OpenStack review queue. So you have links here. Okay, so after we did this 400 nodes run, we figured out that yes, we technically can probably push boundaries of OpenStack and start moving to the bigger scale. So, and at those time it was again like MOS reference architecture, which was good for small scale, but never worked for 1,000 nodes scale. And the biggest problem which we faced at this time was monolithic architecture of our controller nodes. So when you go to bigger scale, it's not possible to fit all those OpenStack components in such a way that they can fit this single hardware server. So you need to figure out how to like properly place them in order to be able to handle all this payload which is generated by OpenStack components like Nova compute nodes, Neutron agents. So those guys are pretty chatty and they generate a lot of traffic even to sustain the operational state of OpenStack cloud. So at this time, actually, you probably saw those interesting projects which were built around containers. So Cola Mesos was our like first attempt to figure out, okay, so how we can reuse whatever containers are available or were available at this time in OpenStack. So how we can effectively use them in our lab to quickly change the configuration and the layout of services. So for that, we created this Cola Mesos project, which was like moderately successful, but it was never intended to use it at the production. So this was science project to make sure that we have some tools in our lab to manage OpenStack services individually. So later, Fuel CCP created like containerized control plane, which was trying to address problems which we faced and address the limits which we faced by using Mesos frameworks. So we switched again to upstream and created this Fuel CCP project to use Python and Cola containers and properly place them right now at this time on top of Kubernetes. And MCP, which is our current Mirantis product, also like explores and uses the same approach, so how to like flexibly place OpenStack components across the hardware nodes, but it uses a different approach. So once we had this framework and tooling for services placement. So the next problem appeared. So we didn't know how to properly place them. So there were no any capacity rules, and we had to do everything from scratch. And frankly, it was like try, learn, try, fail, learn, and then go to success. So we specified like two specific approaches which we would use there. So first of all, we were trying to create those hardware resource profiles for each OpenStack service, so that you don't need to run it in order to plan your capacity or to like design your architecture for your cloud. So as soon as you know how much specific OpenStack service will use hardware resources, specific like CPU and memory, you can actually do like simple math and figure out how you will like distribute them. And for that, thanks to Clint Byron, who actually came to our performance working group IRC channel and suggested to use actually fake Nova drivers so that we can emulate most of the OpenStack control plane activities without actually using a lot of hardware resources for running VMs with workloads. So for control plane measurements, you don't need to run actual VMs, but you need to be able to simulate all those activities and traffic patterns which appears when you actually schedule a VM to be created on the Nova compute node. So this is like brief highlights of what those profiles looks like. So this was a Liberty timeframe when we were running 1,000 node cluster in form of like containers on top of Kubernetes. And what we did, it was very simple actually test. So this is by not any stretch production layout. So it was a very simplistic way how to measure those hardware resource usage patterns by OpenStack components. So we took exactly one instance of each service. We put them to a dedicated like physical machine, and we were running 1,000 fake compute nodes and started our rally testing and started to load OpenStack Cloud with workloads. We started to generate a lot of requests to create a VM. So by the end, we simulated the situation when you have OpenStack Cloud with 20,000 VMs running on top of it. Obviously, at this test, those VMs were ephemeral, so they didn't exist. But all the mechanics which happens when you create this VM, this mechanics was very well preserved, and we were able to measure all those usages. So you might ask why we have no scheduler, why we have 8 instances of it. Because it appears that Nova scheduler is a bottleneck. And it is a such bottleneck that you cannot actually saturate the single Nova API service with having only one Nova scheduler. So Nova scheduler will work so slow that Nova API will just sit and wait while scheduler will figure out where to place this VM. So we had to like increase the number of schedulers just to make sure that we can actually push more loads to the other OpenStack services. Okay, so and now we go to the most like interesting part. So is it possible to push limits to 5,000 nodes? So Yes, we did this like exercise on 1,000 nodes, and we knew that we can actually do this, and we knew the way how we will do this. So, but at this time, we decided to move from those like fake environments where we didn't have actual VMs. So we decided to move to the more realistic scenario where you have actual novel compute nodes which able to run some VMs. We used nested virtualization for that. So it's not probably the real production environment, but it was close enough so that we can emulate all possible behaviors which you can actually find and which you can meet in your production environment. So, and again, like Kubernetes environment was used to control all those containers with Novog computes and with OpenStack services. So, as soon as we have like flexibility in our lab, because as all those Novog computes right now, containers which are a part of resource, a part of replication controller in Kubernetes, we can actually easily change the number of computes without redeploying the whole cloud. So we like specifically, we used like several number of compute nodes to figure out what is the behavior of the services and resource usage when you use different, when you have different number of compute nodes. So, as you see, memory consumption is one of the biggest problem for our well-known RabbitMQ service. So, RabbitMQ is really greedy for hardware resources and actually for both memory and CPU. And at some specific number of compute nodes, you will see that your RabbitMQ instance will not fit to your to the like boundaries or to available capacity of your physical server, which is used to host this RabbitMQ. So there are definitely like scale boundaries which right now we can predict based on our results, and we can actually find, so when we have specific hardware allocated for our components, we can actually deduct and figure out what is the optimal or what is the maximum number of compute nodes which might be supported by this hardware. And bottlenecks, yes. So definitely the first suspect and the first problem which you will definitely face when you run OpenStack at scale is RabbitMQ. So there are multiple problems with the way how actually RabbitMQ system is used by OpenStack. So first of all Novog computes, they use message queue to communicate with Novog conductor and other OpenStack components. So as a result, more compute nodes you have, more connections you have to RabbitMQ. And unfortunately, when we run 5,000 nodes cluster, we have about 40,000 connections to RabbitMQ. And RabbitMQ does not handle those connections very well because those components, they send a lot of traffic. So it's not only about number of connections, but it's also about the size of the message. Because RabbitMQ, when you use HA queues, it has to store them on hard drive for the reliability purpose. And if you like set up time to live like very big for your queue, you will end up with server which just sits and manage files on your hard drive, saving all those messages. So there are a few tricks which we had to do in order to have working OpenStack cloud on 5,000 nodes. So yes, we were able to run it successfully so that we can actually run rally tests which generate user, which actually simulates user activities like creating VMs, creating Cinder volumes, uploading images. So you can do this at 5,000 nodes, but you have to like tweak several components. So here there are like some details what we did. So we used RabbitMQ cluster with load balancer in front of us so that we can actually distribute all those connections across multiple physical nodes. So we decreased like time to live to make sure that we do not choke RabbitMQ with large number of messages which it will save and keep on hard drives. And at some period of time, we had to actually put two dedicated MQ cluster for Neutron specifically and Nova just to make sure that those two services do not actually affect each other. So database was the second problem and a second bottleneck which we found at this scale. So again, if you run a lot of OpenStack components and specifically for Nova, there is a notion of workers. So you have a service instance, but this instance actually spawns a specific number of workers. And for each worker, you have actually a dedicated database connection pool. So as a result, if you are not very careful with those configuration parameters, with number of workers and the size of database pools, you will end up with situation when you have your database with literally like tens, thousands of connections, and MySQL specifically does not handle this situation very well. So you will see a lot of like delays, a lot of reconnections, and a lot of actually lock situation. So as a result, the overall performance of OpenStack services will actually degrade because they will just sit and wait for the database operations. So please be careful with those numbers. And the last but not the least, Nova scheduler. It still doesn't work well, unfortunately. So I know that there are several initiatives right now running in OpenStack Nova to actually fix this specific problem with scheduling. So if you run a single instance of scheduler, which is unfortunately a preferable way to run it, you will not be able to successfully spawn VMs on 5,000 nodes. It will be so slow that Nova API will start retrying those operations because the previous one will not finish within 3 minutes, which is a standard delay in Nova API. So the workaround which you can use is to run multiple schedulers, but because of Nova scheduler architecture and approach, there might be issues with specific placement rules and specific filters which rely on the fact that they know exact situation and exact resource allocation on your cluster. And this will not happen when you have multiple schedulers because they see and they look onto the OpenStack resource pools individually, not actually communicating with each other. So we had a very nasty problem in one of our customer accounts when we had a specific use case when we had to place huge VMs on specific and dedicated hardware. So we end up with situation when we had multiple schedulers which were trying to put a VM onto the same host. And those attempts to place, they were failing. So it was like heat template, which was trying to place 300 VMs on 300 physical nodes. First one VM was created. All other VMs were not created because scheduler, which didn't know that the specific hardware node already allocated by another scheduler, was sitting and trying to reschedule this VM to already allocated physical host. So that might be definitely a problem when you run multiple schedulers. So it's in specific configuration and in specific use cases, it will not work. So as a summary, and we have 10 minutes before the end, that's good. So as a summary, I can say that yes, you can technically run OpenStack cluster with 5,000 nodes. It will work with standard vanilla OpenStack components, including Neutron DVR. So that's, I would say, the only option if you run your networking at this scale. Nova will work, but you need to figure out how to work around the problem with scheduler. Shared services, again, you can work around and scale them individually or split them between multiple OpenStack services and run multiple RabbitMQ cluster or databases. So it's all possible to do. So you can successfully run OpenStack at 5,000 nodes, and we did this. So now we are looking to the next step, and we are looking to push those boundaries to 10,000 and figure out, will actually OpenStack architecture support such scale or not? So probably see you next year with new data and new numbers. Thank you. Questions, please, yes.
I have a question for you. So unfortunately, there was a session this morning that was canceled or didn't show, but is the scaling from 400 to 5,000, is there any insights that you could give from scaling from, say, 80 to 200? Is there anything that similar to what we talked about here?
If you are talking about sessions this morning, I don't know.
No, but I mean, yeah.
Yes.
So, did you have any talks about last year? Maybe it was on a smaller scale, or were some of the things that you talked about here, was some of that relevant to going from, say, 80 to 200 or something like that?
Yes. So, I actually published a link on those docs, openstack.org, performance team. So, we have specific numbers for different sizes of clouds. So, yes, there are numbers for 150, for 200, 350. So there are different numbers which you can use. And there is much more detailed information about tests and results. So there are some different usage patterns and data for MySQL, RabbitMQ, how they behave. So you can find them online. I don't think we had a session on the previous year about this. Yes, it's all there. So if you go there, you'll find very detailed report and you can figure out. Because generic guidelines, yes, you need to figure out what's your usage pattern, how much VMs you create, how frequently you create. And based on that, you can figure out what's the rate of requests to your API. And based on our resource usage profile, you can figure out, if I have Nova API, which is under the pressure of user requests with the rate of 2 requests per second. So here is the response time from this API, and here is the resource usage. And based on that, you will figure out so how to which hardware allocate for your OpenStack service and how to actually place them across different hardware. So the biggest advice is to get rid of monolithic architecture where you just like dump everything to one host and then try to figure out why it doesn't work. Yes. Yes.
Is it possible maybe to try to scale it out, like create 10 nodes,
probably in Q9 or sort of 3? We tried that. So yes, you can run RabbitMQ as a cluster. And especially if you use active-active configuration, when you actually have a load balancer in front of it and put different connections to different physical servers, yes, it will work. But there are problems with RabbitMQ itself, especially with clustering. So what we saw on 5,000 nodes. So we have a cluster which is under high pressure with like incoming messages. It should handle a lot of messages. So first of all, if you use mirrored queue, you have to replicate this traffic across multiple RabbitMQ services. So you will have networking problems. So you need to like carefully design this. Another problem, if a single node fails, your cluster will fail and you will not be able to restore it just because of amounts of payloads. RabbitMQ will probably be able to recover within like few hours, but your Neutron server will die, will lost all his agents, Nova will not work. So you will have a like disaster situation. So it's not even a HA problem right now, it's like capacity problem, so that your components will not be able to handle situation with losing one node. So there is an effort in OpenStack community to replace actually RabbitMQ with ZeroMQ. But they have their own problems at scale.
Thank you. Were you using the filter scheduler or the caching scheduler?
Say it again. Which
were you using the filter scheduler, which is the default?
Yes. We used filter
scheduler. Did you try the caching scheduler?
I don't think so.
Okay. And what was the latest release that you had test results on?
So 5,000 nodes is actually Akata.
Okay.
It was done like months ago.
Okay. Have you started looking at any of Cells V2 to shard the MQ and database issues?
So could you please repeat?
Well, I guess we don't have multiple cells yet, but
yes,
Cells V2 is this thing.
Yes.
So you can shard the deployment.
So I would say, frankly, if you're going to run 5,000 node cluster, you might be not in your mind. So I would go with actually cells approach and run cells instead of having a single control plane.
So we're actually looking for people to do scale testing. So for Pike, when we have multiple cells.
I would say that will be our next step. So take like 10,000 nodes, run cells V2 and figure out how it works.
Sure. So tell Jay. Jay will get it back to us.
Yes. Thanks. Working with Jay every day.
I wonder, first, I love Mirantis distribution, and I've seen that when you guys moved from 8.0 to 9, RabbitMQ messages became much less detailed, notification. Is that the reason what you just showed? And then if it is, my question is, at which point the notification are important because the environment is dynamic and you need to know that someone just changed the name of the instance or added it, right? At which point you recommend the details of the notifications to be?
Yes. So right now we are talking about very specific component, which is called scalometer. So the reason why those notification were changed was the fact that scalometer is not able to handle them. So we had we run our tests in our lab, and we figured out what is the optimal parameters and what are the optimal size for very specific use case when you run scalometer in your environment. And so with scalometer, at least in the configuration which we used, we were unable to use it effectively even on 200 nodes. So you will see those like different options and configurations which you can tweak, and it will depend on your node count. So if you rely on scalometer specifically, 50 nodes is your most actually efficient environment.
When you just said different configuration, you mean in fuel, when you choose scalometer, you will have different configuration options, or?
So there are fuel plugins. So we replaced some of components of scalometer. So there is a so-called telemetry plugin, which is a replacement of scalometer. And so we have two versions of those plugins. So one plugin uses MongoDB as a backend storage, and another one, which is new one, uses Kafka plus something. I don't remember. Is it? This is a new storage backend in scalometer. Panko. Something like that, Panko, yes. So based on whatever you have, you will be able to tweak them. I would say, like, carefully, so don't take right now my words as a given. So you should be able to run telemetry plugin with Kafka and Panko on 1,000 nodes scale. So based on our estimations and simulations, this architecture should be able to sustain this. We never test this as a real, like, production-like environment. So this is probably the next step in our work. So do we have a next speaker in this room?
I have another question. So thanks for the presentation. I see this as a very academic exercise, but do you realistically think that people should run 5,000 nodes with this architecture, or it just to find out results?
Right now,
because having these 5,000 nodes only behind one control plane looks to me very academic.
It is, at some way, yes. It is very academic because this is like test lab and simulation, so this is like science project. But MCP, which is our product, it can actually it can deploy the same architecture. So you can use Kubernetes and place OpenStack controllers as your pods in Kubernetes and individually scale them. How practical is that? I don't know. So it will depend on use case. So how you plan to use your production environment. So if you don't need to run specific amounts of computes, like 1,000 nodes in one data center, so probably you don't need this architecture. You can run multiple small data centers and use like federation. There are some specific use cases which our customer asked to run 1,000 node cluster with a single control plane.
Hi, great presentations. And I have a question about the scalometer. And since the scalometers got the capability to like disable some of the metering elements, is there any consider to like disable some of those unused metering and maybe the performance can be better?
It could be. So frankly, I'm not an expert in scalometers. So yes, I heard about that, but this more like, this is the, my deepest understanding that yes, it's possible to do something with that. Yeah. So I think this is the right actually direction to figure out how efficiently utilize whatever shared services you use. And I remember that in the previous versions of OpenStack, OpenStack services were very chatty, so they send a lot of notifications, even nobody actually reads them. So yes, if you carefully tune this part and reduce amount of messages which are generated, so definitely yes, you can actually improve performance and scalability of scalometer.
And so extend on that, so is there might be a way that you guys trying would like to try to like this kind of direction?
We actually did. So if you go to this OpenStack documentation site, so there are specific tests around scalometer and message queue. So we use Oslo message simulator to emulate those like workloads on RabbitMQ. So we actually did this like profiling of RabbitMQ queues so that we know when it starts failed. And we also run telemetry and we did some like tests for them as well. Those results are available there. So, so and we definitely will continue to do this. So telemetry is one of the components which which is interesting for our customers, they use it. So we definitely will push actually forward this activity as well.
Oh, thanks, I'll check it out, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, any other questions? Otherwise, thank you guys, thank you.